I think it should be called an imprisonment wall. I think that's accurate.
Professor Troy.
I would actually have less of a problem if he called it an imprisonment wall. We could debate wall fence, but that actually is not my point. The reason why apartheid is so problematic is because it feeds a broad campaign to delegitimize Israel, to expel it from the United Nations, to make it an outlaw state, when it's a democracy and a flawed democracy, like America's a flawed democracy, like all countries are flawed. I'm not going to focus on the question of wall versus fence. I'm going to use the T word, terrorism. It's not as if, unlike in South Africa, Israel one day woke up and said, boy, how can we torture the Palestinians? Although if you read Jimmy Carter's book, you'd get that impression, because he doesn't give a full and honest and balanced accounting of the Israeli side of the ledger. What happened was that there was this Oslo peace process, which he also tends to give short shrift to. And as a result of that Oslo peace process, there was a very generous Israeli offer made at Camp David, which Jimmy Carter also tends to skip over. And then in September 2000, the Palestinians launched an approach with lots of terrorism. Yasser Arafat, and there's proof that Yasser Arafat helped underwrite the terrorism, although Jimmy Carter ignores that in the book because he was good friends with Yasser Arafat. And the terrorism was the issue. Both the Israeli left and the Israeli right initially hated the idea of any kind of wall fence barrier, because the Israeli right wanted to incorporate the territories into Israel. The Israeli left wanted to have this vision of everyone living together in what I would love to see, in beautiful peace and harmony. Both of them had to kind of be forced by serious suicide bombings, by a systematic terrorist campaign, by a political culture on the part of the Palestinians that was anti-Semitic. That is anti-Semitic, not Jimmy Carter. That in the Palestinian mosques, on Palestinian television, was attacking not just Zionists but Jews, and attacking the West and celebrating 9/11, and was part of a broader Islamicist surge against the United States, against Israel, against the West, that led to hundreds of deaths of children, of men, of women. That is the context in which the wall fence barrier was built, and that is the context in which these last couple of years, the 6 years of a lack of peace process, has occurred. And without acknowledgement of that, Jimmy Carter at one point says there are two problems in the Middle East. The first is that some Israelis want to grab land, and second is that some Palestinians react to that with violence. And that's very disingenuous. The problem, let's have someone stand up and say it's a messy situation. There are rights and wrongs on both sides. I would have been so much happier with the book if he had said the problem is, yes, some Israelis want Palestinian land, and there's a complicated historical, legal, strategic debate over that. And two, there are Palestinians who want to destroy the Jewish state. How do we get out of that tension? Until we acknowledge the problems on both sides, the weaknesses on both sides, the failures on both sides, we're not going to get to the peace that Jimmy Carter claims to achieve. And I think what he's done is he's undermined his status as a mediator, as an honest broker, by using this incendiary term and by coming out with a book which, frankly, is shoddy. He tends to quote Arafat rather than quoting Palestinian Hamas documents. He quotes Assad, the president of Syria, allowing him to kind of give a spin on events rather than giving facts. And that's the problem with this propagandistic work.
Well, Gil Troy and Norman Finkelstein, we're going to come back to this debate on Jimmy Carter's book, Palestine, Peace, Not Apartheid, in a minute.
Would you have a pen?
Cloudy Day by John Fahey here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're having a debate on Jimmy Carter's book, Palestine, Peace, Not Apartheid, with Gil Troy, professor of American history at McGill University in Montreal. Among his books, Why I Am a Zionist, Israel-Jewish Identity and the Challenges of Today, Norman Finkelstein joins us here in our New York Firehouse studio. He's a professor of political science at DePaul University in Chicago. His latest book is Beyond Chutzpah, on the Misuse of Anti-Semitism and the Abuse of History. And Ethan Bronner's review, long-awaited, that came out yesterday in the New York Times Book Review. He says this book has something of a Rip Van Winkle feel to it, as if little had changed since Carter diagnosed the problem in the 70s. All would be well today, he suggests, if his advice then had been followed. Forget al-Qaeda. The name does not appear in this book. The nuclear ambitions of Iran and the rise of Taliban in Afghanistan. If Israel had, quote, refrained from colonizing the West Bank, he asserts, there would have been a comprehensive and lasting peace. Bronner's talking about Carter, of course. And he goes on to say the debate about the Israeli occupation, quote, will shape the future of Israel. It may also determine the prospects of for peace in the Middle East and perhaps the world, quoting Jimmy Carter. And Bronner says this is an awfully narrow perspective. Before I get your response, Professor Finkelstein, I wanted to go for a minute to Brent Scowcroft. He was speaking yesterday on This Week with George Stephanopoulos. Stephanopoulos had asked him about the significance of the Israel-Palestine conflict. Of course, Brent Scowcroft is the former National Security Advisor for President Bush Sr.
What it would do is change the psychological climate of the region. What we have is a number of different issues all coming together. And the region is in great turmoil. And there's a great sense in the region of historical injustice on the part of the Muslims. And this would change that. This would see us as participating and helping in a problem which is central to the region, which has been a gnawing sore for Muslims for 50 years.
That was President Bush Sr.'s former National Security Advisor, Lieutenant General Brent Scowcroft. Professor Finkelstein.
I'll get to that point in half a moment. Let me just address the questions that were raised by Professor Troy. On the question of Camp David and the offer, I don't think for Democracy Now! Audiences we have to go over that ground, because when Shlomo Ben-Ami was here,
The former foreign minister
of Israel and one of the main negotiators at Camp David, he said, frankly, were I a Palestinian, I would not have accepted the offer at Camp David, and exactly for the reasons that Carter outlines in the book, namely, Palestinians were asked to make such monumental concessions that no Palestinian leader could, in good conscience, let alone as a representative of the Palestinians, accept such an offer. That was the position of Arafat. It's also the position to which Shlomo Ben-Ami agreed. On the question of terrorism, as Professor Troy calls it, the big T word, I think there's a certain confusion about what was the sequence of events. The Second Intifada begins September 28, 2000. Between September 28, 2000 and March 2003, there wasn't one Palestinian terrorist attack. The suicide bombings began 5 months after the beginning of the Second Intifada. Why did it begin? Well, the first month of the Intifada, the ratio of Palestinians to Israelis killed was 20 to 1. And if you read Shlomo Ben-Ami's book, he states there that had Israel not so overreacted to the Palestinian protests, which were overwhelmingly nonviolent in the first months, the huge explosion that subsequently occurred probably would not have happened. But those first 5 months, when Israel was killing 20 times as many Palestinians, overwhelmingly nonviolent protesters, to each Israeli killed, that part has been completely effaced from the historical record. Now, it's true, suicide bombings began. And one possible way to avert them, not the only one, but one possibility, was to build a wall. Well, but there's an option. If you want to prevent suicide bombings against your country, just like if you want to prevent a neighbor from intruding on your property, you build a fence or a wall, but you build it along the border, the internationally recognized border. Israel didn't do that. It used the suicide bombings as a pretext to confiscate 10% of Palestinians.